Picture the perfect international vacation. Historic architecture, quaint cafes, beautiful beaches. It sounds great. Now, imagine getting there. You've got a 14-hour cramped flight, a long wait in customs, and a whole lot of jet lag to look forward to. Introducing a new way to travel, intranationally. Get all that international charm without ever leaving the country. Get all the culture, cuisine, and beaches right here in St. Augustine, Pontevedra. Travel intranationally. Visit floridashistoriccoast.com to learn more.
This is Legal Live with Eddie and Chuck Farah. They're talking the latest legal news and answering your questions. To call Legal Live and ask Eddie and Chuck a question, grab your phone and dial 855-765-1045. That's 855-765-1045.
Hello, hello. Welcome to Legal Live, brought to you by Farah and Farah on 104.5 WOKV, Jacksonville's News and Talk. I'm Shefalika, and we are live in studio with Eddie and Chuck Farah. And you can give us a call at 855-765-1045. How's it going, gentlemen? How are you doing today?
Well, good, Shefalika.
All good.
Good to be here.
That's awesome. Well, it looks like at the start of the show, we already have a caller on the line, which is great.
let's go for it.
Let's go for it. All right, Stevie.
Hey, Stevie.
From the north side, you have a question about insurance. What's going on?
Yeah, good morning. How are you? Good day to you all.
Doing well.
How are you? Good. Quick question about insurance. A while back, I was listening to your program, and y'all were mentioning that if you have a child, even though they're of age or not of age, if they're under your insurance policy in any way, shape, or form, an automobile policy or whatever, and they go out and do something irresponsible and dumb, that technically you're still on the hook for that. Mm-hmm. Just about correct?
That's not exactly correct. They can be on your insurance policy. That's okay because they live in your household. It's the ownership of the vehicle you want to be concerned about. If they've got their own car, you want it to be in their name alone. That way, if they cause an accident, even though they're on your policy, you cannot be personally sued because the car's in their name alone. Like, you don't want it. Like, your car should be in your name alone. And your wife's car should be in her name alone. It's okay if the cars are on the same policy. The policy has nothing to do with it.
Okay. The gist of my situation is she's not 18 yet, so obviously the car's in my name. Mm-hmm. So it's her vehicle and my vehicle. She can own a car.
She can own it because she's underage. But see, the thing is, there's another Florida law. Yeah. You brought up a good point. Something I failed to bring up. You just reminded me. That if whoever signed for the driver's license when she turned 16, there's a Florida statute that says even though you're not on the car, you're responsible for her until she's 18.
Okay.
Yeah. If you signed for her driver's license.
So title wouldn't mean anything in that
situation.
Yeah,
I think there's a Florida law, unless it's been repealed. Okay. But until they're 18, you got the picture. You switch one.
She could title that car in her name under the age of 18.
Oh yeah, you can own something.
Maybe it was the insurance because the insurance wouldn't write her assault policy. Does that sound more in line?
That may be it.
Yeah, but she can still own the car and just be on your insurance policy.
Okay.
I mean, there are.
Okay.
You don't have to be.
So here's what you're trying to protect yourself from. Insurance pays up to a limit. You're trying to protect yourself for something over that limit, and that's why when we talk about putting in and. Your name alone or her name alone, it's protecting you for those situations where you could put your personal assets at risk. Because, insurance is going to pay, she can be on your policy, but there is a limit. Now, like Eddie brought up, she's under 18. Whoever signed for that driver's license could be responsible. If that's you.
Right.
Then you may want to make sure you're fully insured, over.
Well, what he could also do though, Chuck, is if Steve signed for the license, but everything that Steve owns is his wife's name, you're protected. That's why you want to have the cars in my household. Everybody's car is in their own individual name. My wife's car is in her name. Yeah. My car is in my name. If I get sued, they can't touch anything in our joint names. And we own, if you own everything jointly with your wife, you're protected from somebody coming trying to sue and take your stuff.
So really, if you do something, but your vehicle is co-owned with you and your wife, they can't come after you that way?
No, if it's co-owned, if you and your wife own it together and you have joint assets, they can come up from, they can come after what y'all own together. Yeah, they can come.
But if you own them individually, your wife's car couldn't be messed with because right. She's got her own policy.
She's got her own car. You know, she's on your policy. She owns her own car.
But hold on now. Joint assets, if you're negligent. If you're individually sure. negligent and there's a joint asset with you and your wife, then I don't think they can
No, they can't. No,
they
no.
can't come after those assets.
Not if a car is in his name alone.
Now, if you're both negligent, let's say that I'll give you a scenario. Your wife owns the car. You're driving her car and you cause an accident. Okay.
They can go after your aunt.
Now, even if you have joint assets, you're both responsible for the accident because the owner's responsible for the driver's actions, and they can come and collect collect those assets.
Okay, makes sense. Real quick last scenario, and then I'll get off the line there. So let's assume my daughter's 18 now. The car's in her name, but she's still under my insurance policy that has me and my wife listed on it.
Right.
Are we at risk of anything at that point?
You're cool there, unless she's driving your car. If she's driving her car when she causes an accident, and the car's in her name alone, you have no worries.
Okay, even if she's under our insurance policy, I'm
yes.
still okay.
Don't worry about the policy. Okay. Everybody tries to say, "Well, she's under my policy, I'm responsible." No, being under the policy or in the policy doesn't make you responsible. The insurance companies typically want to insure everybody in the household. That's why if you look at your application, when you file for car insurance, they're going to ask you, give us every driver that lives in your household. Because they want to underwrite all that. And you can,
Yeah, I just went through all that. And if you don't, they go through leaps and bounds to have you exclude somebody. Right. And it's pretty messy.
You may not even own a car, but if you're a driver, they want to know about it.
Sure.
You're in the household.
That's perfect. You cleared it up.
All right. Thanks a lot, Steve.
And thanks for clearing that up. I appreciate it.
Anytime. Call us
call back, man.
If you have any questions.
Yeah, have a great weekend.
Don't forget about us.
Yeah.
Thank you so much for calling, Stevie. That was great.
Yeah.
Well, right now we're about to take our first quick break, but we will be right back very soon. You're listening to Legal Live on 104.5 WOKV, Jacksonville's News and Talk. Give us a call anytime, 855-765-1045. We'll be right back after this quick break. Welcome back. You're listening to Legal Live, brought to you by Farah and Farah on 104.5 WOKV, Jacksonville's News and Talk. I'm Shafalika, and I'm joined here with Eddie and Chuck. We have got another caller on the line, Thomas from Orange Park. You are having some foundation issues with your house. What's going on?
Yeah, so we purchased our home in 2018. We bought it from a couple that flips houses. They bought it from somebody that sold it to them that had foundation issues previously. My neighbor's been telling me that they rented the property out and they kept repairing the damages instead of fixing it. The people that sold it to us had to have known about it because they had my other neighbor patch holes outside and inside, and when we bought it, everything looked fantastic, but about 6 months into it, we started to get cracks in various places in our flooring and walls, and we've seen several real estate attorneys. I had one real estate attorney that was about to take the case until he found out it was in Clay County, and then he didn't want to take it because he's old. He didn't want to drive. I've actually used your firm before. It's fantastic. We've had great results with you guys. But I've contacted y'all about it, but I really kind of just got pushed around. Mm-hmm. Is there anything we can do to maybe get compensated from these people to pay for the damages?
All right. Do you have did you try rent it by your homeowner's insurance?
We have. It's not covered. Settling is not covered in our homeowner's insurance.
They've told you that?
We've looked through the contract.
Yeah, but have you talked to a lawyer about it to look at it?
No, we have not.
Because what kind of damage? What is it going to cost to repair? Do you have an estimate?
We haven't even had an estimate yet. My neighbor had his repaired, and it was upwards of $15,000 to $20,000. Mm-hmm. So that's ballpark of what we're probably looking at.
So did you know there was foundation issues when you purchased them?
No, he didn't
know
it.
No, we didn't know because they patched everything.
It up. Oh, I thought
they patched up.
Did you have a home inspection done before you purchased it?
We did, but because everything, I guess, was patched up, they didn't find anything. So they patched the sheetrock. They patched all the cracks outside. It's a block foundation that's filled with concrete. They patched all the block, and they patched everything up. I mean, they had brand new flooring put in. They patched all the sheetrock up, and now where our chimney is, we have severe cracking on both sides of the chimney. Our sliding glass door is getting harder to close every day, and it's unethical to do that too, especially to a younger couple.
I got it.
The seller might be responsible.
Well, the seller is responsible. They were aware of it. I mean, they were supposed to disclose it. There's a Florida law that requires them to disclose to you any kind of defect like that.
Was there a broker involved?
And they don't. They're responsible for it.
We used Exit Realty, but I mean, I can't blame the realtor. I think the fault goes back to the flippers that sold us the home. You know, they had my neighbor. One of my neighbors has a sheetrock company, and he actually patched the sheetrock and the foundation outside. And he was willing to write up a testimony back when we were speaking with other attorneys about it. Unfortunately, he passed away last year from lung cancer. But, I mean, he told me all that in person. And, I mean, we're so overwhelmed. I mean, we haven't even had an estimate because we know we just can't afford it.
What kind of contact have you had with the seller?
None. Contact was done through Exit Realty.
I mean, you haven't contacted them and said, "Hey, do you have insurance to cover this?"
No, we have not.
Yeah, you should. Well, if they're still in business.
What?
Yeah, it's just a couple, and that's all they do is flip houses. I mean, I was thinking about that. I was thinking about just calling them and saying, "Hey, if you don't pay for this, I'm going to wrap my vehicle." You know, but then I don't know if that's slander or not, you know. So
slander because it's true. Slander is all when you're not telling the truth.
That's true.
If you're telling the truth, it's not slander. You
know? I mean, I would hate to do that to a business, but it's just, I mean, I don't know what to do anymore. Like, they should have to pay for that damage. You know?
Because the thing is, you're going to, you know, a lot of times lawyers will look at cases because you really want a lawyer that's going to probably, you want a lawyer who's going to handle it on a contingency, because you can find lawyers that you can pay an hourly rate to, and they'll handle it, but they're going to get paid whether you win or lose. You know what I'm saying? I mean, you have a lawyer, give me a $10,000 deposit, and I'll file a lawsuit. Well, $10,000, I could almost fix the whole thing, you know? I'm going to give it to you.
Yeah, exactly.
And I may win, I may lose. I'll lose my $10,000, and I've still got the sinking house, you know? So it's a tough decision. I mean, why don't you think about this? I'm going to give you an alternative, you know, and I think you can do it. I mean, believe it or not, this is a case you can handle on your own. The Florida, as of the beginning of the year, Florida has increased the minimum amount for county court. If you're talking about a $20,000 repair, that's why you want to find out how much it is. You can probably go through small claims court. And you can file that on your own, you know, and you probably don't need a lawyer. All you need is someone to come in, and the guy who's going to give you the estimate for the house, let him bring him to court, and he's going to want the job, say, yeah, the house is sinking, or you can take pictures of that. And you got somebody that comes in and says, yeah, it's sinking. I gave him an estimate of $25,000 or whatever it is. You can probably do that on your own without a lawyer.
Yeah, and I was also thinking of contacting all the foundation companies in the area and seeing if they've ever put an estimate on the house before, because that would kind of prove that that they knew foundation damage was done.
Right.
And
that's a good idea.
I mean, but what is it? Isn't like the minimum of small claims like 5,000?
No, they raised it. They just increased it. I think it's 20,000, 25,000 something. And I think it goes up to 30.
Really?
And I think it may even go up to 30 next year. Yeah. So you can go down to the county courthouse. You know who sold it to you. They're going to walk you through the process. They'll help you prepare the paperwork. And then the sheriff, you'll file the lawsuit. It'll cost you $200, $300 to file it, but you'll get that money back. The judge, if he rules in your favor, he's going to order them to pay you that filing fee back. And then you'll pay the sheriff to go serve the papers. We'll show you how to do that.
Now, but, as far as my job goes, like how long would this take? Like how?
Well, it's small claims. I mean, there's no jury. You'll go in front of a judge. Typically, I don't know how they'll do it. They're doing it now, but you serve the papers. They give them a chance to file a response, and then you call the judge's office. He sits for a hearing. He'll give you time. He'll look at everybody's calendar, make sure everybody can be there. You know, and so I mean, the judges here are real flexible with that. They're going to make sure they're going to make it convenient for everybody.
Gotcha.
But you don't need a lawyer. This is a case you can handle yourself. You know the case better than anyone.
Okay. I'm going to definitely look into that. The last question I have is there a time, what's the word I'm looking for?
Time statute of limitations.
Well, you know, it happened in 18. Yeah, I mean.
You still got some time ahead.
When did it happen? When did you purchase
it? I think we bought it in 2018. I'm pretty sure.
Could be a 4-year statute. Yeah. I mean, we're into 22 right now. Do you know when in 18 you filed it, you bought it?
Okay. Well, I will go ahead and look into that. I'll contact the Clay County Courthouse.
Breach of contract is 5 years. If you want to say a breach of contract, you got 5 years. If you claim a negligence claim, it's 4 years.
Okay, I'll go ahead and get on that.
Yep.
I appreciate you guys. Y'all are awesome.
Yeah,
thank you
a lot.
So much.
Good luck on that. Let us know what happens.
Thank you.
All right, thank you.
That was a really interesting question, you know, because that house is collapsing, the house is cracking. That's a little scary to live there.
Yeah, I know. You pay all that, you know, you pay all that money, and, you know, it's not like you can walk away from it. You got a mortgage. You got a mortgage company. Mm-hmm. If they got a mortgage, you got a contract. You know, you're gonna get a lawsuit. You're gonna get a foreclosure.
Right.
Ruin your credit. I mean, it's just a domino effect of bad things happening.
Yeah.
So he's really got a. But you know, this new small claims. It's not even a small. The new county court procedure makes it a lot easier for him to handle it. Even if the other side gets a lawyer, you know, the judge is going to be fair and follow the law.
Yeah, I agree.
He's not going to give the other side an advantage because they have a lawyer.
Yeah, that's true. Well, you've been listening to Legal Live, brought to you by Farah and Farah on 104.5. We'll be right back after this quick break. All right, welcome back to Legal Live, brought to you by Farah and Farah on 104.5 WOKV, Jacksonville's News and Talk. Give us a call at 855-765-1045. We've got a caller on the line, Steve, who has been very patient waiting for to speak with us. What's going on, Steve?
Well, before I go to my question or my comment to the previous caller, I think I know a lawyer that could help him resolve that case. It's not going to be a very quick settlement, though. I can tell off the air the lawyer's name.
I don't have his phone number. Maybe he's listening. Let's give the lawyer's name. Maybe he can call him. But I really.
If you don't mind me saying it, I can tell you on the air.
Well, I mean, why not? I mean, we're here to help David, people.
You know? Okay. Well, David Graham helped me sue my builder. And, of course, it took a couple of years to get everything resolved, but I was very happy with the outcome. So David Graham is someone that might be helping. Back to my comment or question, the first caller was talking about insurance policies. Something that I have learned since living in Florida and not many people are aware of, situation first, my daughter was like 17 years old but did not have a driver's license. Well, I get a bill from my insurance company adding her to my policy, and, of course, I asked them, I said, well, how are you able to do this? I said, well, she's legal age driving, and she lives in your household, so therefore we can add her to your policy. I said, okay, well, what's her driver's license number? Since there's four people in the house and only three cars, which car is she going to be signed to? The next day, I was in my insurance agent's office, and he resolved that very quickly. I did not know that in the state of Florida, they can add you to your policy if you are legal driving age, even though They don't have a driver's license.
Well, it's an underwriting issue. It's up to the insurance company. That's your company.
Right.
And it depends on the questions that you are asked on the application. Everything goes back to the application. If the question is, give us all the drivers, everybody in your household who has a driver's license. Sometimes they may, then you could say, well, my daughter doesn't have a driver's license. I can answer that question no. Or they may ask, give us everyone in the household who's of driving age. Then you would have to answer yes and include your daughter's name. So it's all based on the application. I mean, how did the insurance company know you had a 17-year-old girl living in your household? There must have been a question or something on the application that alerted them to that.
Well, what happened, my other daughter was involved in an accident, and they called to get a statement from my daughter. And in the course of the conversation, the insurance company said, who's in your household and what are their ages? And my daughter didn't know to not answer the question. She's just thinking, well, okay, you know, my daughter's 17 years old, and next thing I know, I'm getting a bill because they had asked my other daughter what was her name and what was her birth date, what was her age, et cetera.
Well, they probably assumed she had a driver's license.
Yeah.
That's what they assumed, because if she was 17, I mean, most people, you know how the kids are. They want a driver's license pretty quickly.
And then the other situation, my stepdaughter and her husband lived in our home briefly. Mm-hmm. And after they married, and my insurance agent said, well, what are their ages? And I said, I told them, and what are their names? And I told them, well, we're going to have to change your insurance policy to include them. I said, wait a minute. They have their own policy.
Yeah.
And my name is not on their title. Their names are not on the title of any of my cars. And we had to go down with their policy and show my insurance agency that they were on their own policy,
right?
But because they were living with us,
right,
there was some kind of law in the state of Florida that my insurance company could add them to my policy.
Yeah, it's not a law; it's an underwriting thing. They're assessing the risk. They're saying, okay, all these drivers are in the house. I mean, you know, if you have one driver, it's one premium. If you have 10 drivers in the household, it's another premium. It's all about risk, and they're assessing the risk. So what happens? Well, that's why they ask you those questions. And so when you told them my stepdaughter and her husband or whatever are living in the household, that's risk. Now, what you would do to keep them off your policy and so you're not being assessed and paying for all that, you would have them listed as excluded drivers. So if they just drive, you got to be careful because you really can't let them drive your car, because if they cause an accident and they're driving your vehicle, and there's no insurance coverage because they're excluded out of the policy. So That's the other thing. I mean, if you want them included on your, if you want to loan your car out to them, then you got to have them, and they're living with you, then you got to let them know that, and you got to pay that extra premium. But if they're excluded, if they're excluded, you don't have coverage, but you don't pay.
Exactly. Thank you for your help, Ben. Y'all have a great weekend.
I appreciate it. Thanks.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Yeah.
I really like how our callers, like, relate to one another and can, like, give each other feedback and advice as well. That's good.
Yeah.
That's what we're here for, is to help
you
people.
You know, life experiences, Shefalika, you learn a lot.
Yeah.
I mean, a lot of people have been through things, and that's why that's what we want people to learn and gain some knowledge from this show. And that gentleman that gave us that attorney's name, that'd be great. Maybe
David
can
Graham,
handle.
I believe
David
it was.
David Graham. I hope that person, Thomas, right? Thomas was still listening, and he could get that person's name.
Mm-hmm.
But really, now that the small claims courts limits have, the thresholds have been lifted to higher amounts, you know, you may not have to have a lawyer.
I think that's amazing, because I always thought it was just $5,000 cap, that's it. But now $20,000, $25,000, maybe $30,000 next year.
Yeah, and it's going up.
That's great.
Yeah. Which is a good thing.
You know, I really love the community here. We haven't gotten to, like, any of your legal issues. We've just had caller after caller, which is so great. It's exciting.
Yeah.
Thank you all for calling in and listening. We're about to go to break, and we'll be right back.
Yep.
We've got another caller on the line, Mark in Mandarin. Hang in there. We'll be right back to you. You're listening to Legal Live, brought to you by Farah and Farah on 104.5 WOKV, Jacksonville's News and Talk. Thank you so much for giving us a call, and hang in there. We'll be right back with another segment. right, welcome back. You're listening to Legal Live, brought to you by Farah and Farah. We've got two callers on the line. We've got Mark in Mandarin with a house-related question. What's going on, Mark? You there?
Hello,
just
Mark.
A moment.
Hello.
There you go.
Yes, ma'am.
How's it going?
How can we help you?
Just fine. How you doing, Mr. Fair?
Pretty good, man. Thanks for calling in.
Just want to thank you for all you do for our community. You do a great help and have been for since the late 70s, and you're a great help.
All right, thank you very much.
My question is that my landlord come and signed a new lease with me several months ago, and then they sold my house and told me that now I pay the new owners. But when the new owners came and introduced themselves, they told me that they bought the house from somebody else, not who I have a lease with. So I'm kind of confused until my lease ends. Where do I go? What do I do? Who do I pay?
Wow. Did you go online and see who owned the house? And you can check that property records.
I just found this out about an hour ago, so I haven't been home yet.
Yeah.
Well, the new land.
I would go to the cityofjack.net. Is it? Yeah, coj.net website, and you can find out who owns the house.
The new landlord, partners, new landlord owns it. So do I pay them or do I go back to the lease that I had before?
Yeah, you got to find out. They told you that the person you were paying the rent to did not own the house?
Did they own it when you entered the lease?
I believe so. They said that they bought the house from somebody else. I thought it was a lady and it ended up being a man.
Yeah.
A lady and her boyfriend, whoever's who I rented it from, it was under her name. The bills came in her name for, I've had this place for 4 years.
Yeah.
And now they sell it. I just want to know, do I pay rent to the new lady who bought it? She officially bought it, so do I owe her? Do I owe the old people?
Yeah, because I'm sure the purchase of the house, they probably worked that out, so you'll need to just call the who you've been paying to see.
But now I would just confirm that the new owner on the, just go to the city website. Are you in Duval County?
Yes, sir. I'm in Mandarin.
Oh, yeah, that's right. Then just go to the website and make sure that the person, but it could be an LLC or something. I mean, you ought to ask them for some proof that they own it, that they're the new owners.
Yes, sir.
But I would start with the City of Jack's website and just confirm who the owner is. You were probably better off making who they want you to make the check payable to them or to like a company name. Do you know that?
She wanted me to make it to her now, but we were making it through Venmo to somebody before, and it was never an issue. It just, just kind of concerned me that maybe I've been making payments to somebody that never really owned the house to begin with.
Well, that's water under the bridge now. I mean, nobody's coming and asking you for any money. So, I would just find out who the owner, get something from them to show they can show you the deed. Ask them, can you show me some proof that you're the new owners, and who would I make the check payable to? That way you're protected from them.
Well, the old owners are saying that I still have a lease with them, so I owe them.
Oh, they're... Well, I don't know about that. You owe it to the new owners.
That's kind of was my question, was I have a lease with one person that I found out didn't even own the house.
Yep.
And now somebody has bought the house. They say I owe them rent, and the other people say, well, you have a lease with me. Your lease is not up until X. You owe me.
No, well,
who do I really owe?
They don't have possession of the house anymore. I mean,
they'll own it.
Unless they work something out on the sale saying, okay, you can collect the rest of the rent,
Until he's done.
Yeah, as a negotiation of the purchase. But that's why you need to
find out.
Actually contact both parties and actually find the closing lawyer who closed on the house, because that would probably clarify who's owed the rent.
And that's legal document, public document for me to see?
Well, the deed is a legal document. You can see who owns it now. And you can find out from that. You could write that personally, because they'll have an address on the website where they send the tax bill. You could write a letter and say, look, I'm living in this house. I am told I got to pay the rent to the so-called previous owner. You own it now. Who does the rent go to? And you got something in writing where, you're protecting yourself and they come back and say something. But yes, I would hold, yeah. I was just, yeah.
When was the house sold? Was it recently?
In the last couple of days.
Yeah, yeah. So I'm sure that's something that was worked out. If you go back to the lawyer, which could be found in the court record, who
closed. I don't know if he knows a lawyer. I mean, would be on the title policy or something. I don't know if you can get that.
I don't know.
The deed. His name may be on the deed.
Yeah, so but, if you go to if you go there, find out who the lawyer is, give him a call, say, listen, he'll tell you where it belongs because that. I'm sure it was taken care of during the sale of the property. Closing.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
I'm hoping.
That's interesting, where the old owner says, you still owe me the rent. I don't own the house, but I unless that's negotiated at the time of closing, usually when you buy the property, you get the rent.
Right.
I mean, if I buy a shopping center and they start paying rent, I get the money.
Yeah.
I mean,
right.
The rent goes to the old guy, you don't have to.
Yeah, I like that deal. Yeah, you can pay me if you want.
My loyalties go to the new guy.
Yeah. That's odd. But
new guy.
You never know what they negotiated at the closing. Maybe the seller said, well, I want to get rent for the next 6 months. Then you start getting it.
Yeah.
You can negotiate anything.
Yeah, you can negotiate anything. That's my point. And so you go to the lawyer. The lawyer has that agreement.
Right.
Okay. Yeah. Well, cool. Y'all are very informational, as usual.
Good luck, Mark. Appreciate
Thank
it.
You, Mark.
That's
thanks
a heck
for
of a question right there.
That was a
I've
really
never
good.
Heard of that.
I know. Whoa. We always get new stuff on this show. I love it.
Man.
All right, we've got one final caller for you. Robert in Jacksonville also has another house-related question. What's going on, Robert? We got a few minutes left. Let's get to it.
Hi. Can you hear me?
Sure. Yes.
Okay, Mr. Farah, good afternoon. My girlfriend bought an aftermarket homeowner's warranty, on the appliances and so forth. She's got a sprang a leak in the water heater. Due to normal wear and tear. Company sent a evaluator out and they declined it, stating that it was a manufacturer's defect.
Oh.
Now, the water heater is about, I guess, maybe 15, 17 years old. I don't know. She bought the house from another. So my question is, is there a recourse or better yet, if normal wear and tear on the leak is not covered, what would be?
Yeah.
What kind of warranty is that? Well, let me ask you, did she report it to her homeowner's insurance?
No, she hasn't involved them yet.
Yeah, you need to do that.
Well, that's what you want to do. I mean, you could file suit on the warranty.
What kind of damage has been done to the house?
None. It was the damage was simply confined to leakage of the water heater, and there's some water in the basin at the bottom of the thing. So there was no actual damage to the walls or the rest of the house.
Okay. So it may not even be. I mean, you may not even meet your deductible under your homeowner's policy.
Yeah.
Right.
So. I mean, technically you've got a warranty claim, and we, in our office, we handle warranty claims. We sue for we do all that kind of stuff. But if you don't have any damage, I mean, I'm just trying to think of a way to, I mean, what are you going to recover if there's no damage?
It says that the water heater is covered. So we're looking to get the water heater replaced.
The value of the water heater. A 17-year-old water heater, yeah. There's probably an exclusion for that because you wouldn't have to ever buy anything. You could just buy the warranty and replace it.
Or it depreciates so much it's not worth it.
Yeah, it's worth $5. They'll pay you the cash value of it at the time it happened. There's probably some things to look at, but it's probably not something we're going to be interested in because, thank God, you don't have a lot of damage to the house. And a 15-year-old water heater, 15 to 70... It's probably had its life. I mean, that's probably how long they're supposed to last.
That's why you may have a difficult time.
So they would cover something. I'm just trying to figure out under what circumstances.
I think they would cover. Would they cover the dam? I thought if there was like a leak that caused damage to the drywall or something, then you would.
Mm-hmm.
You can recover that.
Nothing like that. It was just the leak fried the electrical. Portions and the water heater went kaput.
Well, have you read the warranty? Did you read the warranty?
Well, in all fairness, she tells me that there is, the short answer is no. But she tells me that there is some kind of provision where that they are right. So I haven't, in all fairness, no, sir, I have not. I guess maybe I'll go ahead and do that and do a little bit more research on it and see if that is explained a little bit better. But just on the surface, like I said, if the thing breaks down, just like our air conditioner had a problem, he came out and fixed that. It was a bad fan or something, a bad part. So I thought that, if the water heater goes down due to normal wear and tear, which that's what I consider to be normal wear and tear, even after 15 years, that it, under the warranty, it should be replaced unless I'm misreading that.
Yeah, I mean, because a warranty doesn't cover everything. I mean, warranties have limitations. I mean, cars come with warranties, but there are limitations on warranties. So you've got to read the documents and a contract like any other contract. And what you agree to in the contract is what the deal is. So I think you got to look at the warranty and see what does that say. If it addresses hot water heaters, if it addresses how old the product is, and so forth, and see what it says.
Okay, fair enough. I'll go back and research a little bit more, and maybe I'll give you a call next week.
I appreciate it. Thanks. We'll be here.
Yeah,
we will
be here.
Have a good day.
Thank you so much for calling, Robert. Well, it's been another fantastic day here at Legal Live, brought to you by Farah and Farah on 104.5 WOKV, Jacksonville's News and Talk. We've had an amazing time talking to all of you callers. Thank you so much for giving us some of your time and asking these amazing questions. We'll see you next week at noon right here on 104.5 WOKV. Thanks for listening.
Frontier presents A Tale of Two Homes.
I moved in with Frontier Gig Fiber and have been gaming and surfing up a storm with super fast speeds.
And I moved in without it and haven't.
So you don't have 100% fiber optic network with 99.99% overall reliability?
That's correct.
Well, it's never too late to upgrade.
Don't just move. Move up. Switch to Frontier Gig Service for just $69.99 a month with autopay and get a $200 Visa reward card on us. Go to frontier.com/moving for complete offer details. Service is subject to availability and all applicable terms and conditions.